Sometimes Mozart subverts these beat hierarchies. In the finale of the B-flat sonata K570, he plays with the potential for melodic contents, attributes, and gestures to cut across normal expectations. Within the Alabrevi time signature, the beat hierarchy is strong on the first minim beat and weak on the second. Yet even within bar one of the theme, the E natural chromatic passing note on the second beat in the right hand is a dissonant melodic value against the B-flat supporting harmony. And if we interpret this dissonance in the way authorized in 18th century theory, then it ought to acquire some additional weight. For instance, we might slur it off, as marked in the score, onto the quaver F that follows, meaning that the E is louder than the F too. Or we might introduce a minuscule pause over the E, elongating it ever so slightly to draw it out. Either way, we'll probably give a little additional volume to it. In all these respects, though, the action enhances the prominence of the E over and above what we would expect if a standard approach to beat hierarchy were applied here. Notions of beat hierarchy always run in parallel with an understanding of the underlying harmonic progressions. So, for instance, in the first episode in this rondo finale of K570, we have a harmonic progression that moves very slowly for the first four bars. Followed by another four-bar pattern, in which the harmonies move rather more quickly. There are two other levels on which knowledge of beat hierarchy can deepen our understanding of this episode and affect the way we play it. Within bars 23 and 25, the strong bars within this four-bar phrase, the static B-flat quaver pattern in the left hand tends to draw our attention to the melodic change above it. Reduced to simple terms, the melodic component consists each time of a rising step D to E-flat in bar 23 and F to G in bar 25, in each case doubled in either sixths or thirds, respectively. This gesture is more complicated than it might at first seem. Is it simply a question of the chords changing on the second minim beat each time, tonic to subdominant? That's what it looks like on the notated page, but we might alternatively think or feel that what we have here is a static B-flat chord persisting through each of these bars that is disturbed by the stepwise melodic sliding, not quite a chord change, but a melodic inflection. Our view of the status of these particular minim beats will perhaps determine the extent to which we draw attention to them in shaping the phrase. But whichever view we take, we'll introduce an enhancement that counterpoints the expected beat hierarchy of strong, weak, as we move through the minim beats of the Alabrevi bar. In each solution, the rising melodic gesture introduces a tension against the default expectation. The momentum is distributed forwards through the bar onto the second minim, rather than fading from first to second. Looking now at the larger hierarchy of bars, namely a bar hierarchy within the phrase, we would expect the pattern to run strong, weak, strong, weak, as we move through these four bars. But the increase in melodic activity in bars 24 and 26 over a hint of the subdominant chord E-flat, each time enhanced by a crotchet changing note or passing note, once again confounds the standard expectation. The precise relation of these bars to bars 23 and 25 will depend on how we treated the harmonies in those bars, whether we thought of them as actual chord changes or as melodic enhancements of a single underlying B-flat chord. Either way, the more definite melodic profile of bars 24 and 26 gives them a relatively greater weight within the theoretical template of strong, weak, than would be normal. Mozart's subtle playing with these values only becomes apparent if we think in relation to beat hierarchies, and in this case, bar hierarchies. Seen against this background, the hierarchy of the next four bars follows relatively straightforwardly. A two-bar sequence, the second a step lower than the first, suggests strong, weak, balanced by a two-bar cadential figure settling on the dominant F, whose melodic shape re-establishes the traditional hierarchy within each bar. Finally, relating all these details to the model of beat or bar hierarchy, our performance of the first half of this episode might seek to convey somehow another subtle subversion, namely that what looks busiest in terms of musical notation, bars 27 to 30, actually proceeds in an entirely straightforward way in relation to 18th century flowcharts, whereas what looks straightforward notationally isn't.